Hello there. So I'm going to add a diagram here to our live. So let's see. There we go. I love having the diagram as I'm chatting. And I already got a comment from somebody like, can you make this a little bigger because the print is so tiny? And so absolutely, yes. So what I'm thinking is that I'll make a post with kind of each of these pieces so that you can follow along with it a little bit easier. But I got a lot of questions and interest last week when we were talking about functional movement disorders, and people were wondering, well, does this apply to 3PD or how does it apply? So I wanted to talk about 3PD, persistent postural perceptual dizziness, and how it is a functional neurologic disorder. And then that is why a lot of how we work with people with functional movement disorders, it's different with dizziness, but a lot of those same principles really apply. And a big piece of this, and hey, by the way, I want to give a shout out to Brian. Hey, Brian, thanks for joining me here. We're talking dizziness. A lot of the principles is what I was saying, a functional neurologic disorder treatment apply to 3PD because it is a functional dizziness. It is a problem with connection in the brain to body. So in the post today, I was talking about this diagram, which the amazing Janine Holmberg, I adapted this from her through a lot of the literature in 3PD and how it might develop. So I just want to talk through it pretty quickly here because I think it leads directly into treatment. So 3PD as a functional neurologic develops because of neuroplasticity, neurons wiring together in different ways. Because of that, kind of gone awry. But it makes sense how it could happen because this is what the brain does in adapting to something. So with 3PD, we start with this initial dizziness event. And this could be really anything. It could be an episode of BPPV. It could be a panic attack. It could be a vestibular nerve infection. It could be any kind of event that causes dizziness. It could be low blood pressure. So it could be many things that could cause that initial dizziness. And then when we have that, we start to have acute adaptation right away. By the way, this could be a concussion. I see this a lot post-concussion. So right away, when our brain and our body experiences dizziness, our brain is super smart and it's going to start adapting to give us safety. It is going to have us start waiting, so taking in visual information a little bit more to keep us steady. That's how we say stay safe. We start to maybe get a little stiff in our posture to try to stay upright and balanced. And that keeps us safe and keeps us from falling, right? It will have us be very vigilant of our surroundings and our environment because, again, we want to stay safe. We don't want to fall. We don't want to lose our balance. And maybe even we don't want to throw up, right? So sometimes the vertigo is so bad we're vomiting. So we get this extra vigilance. It's normal. It's not something wrong with you that these things occur. This actually should occur. That's normal for the brain to have that happen. Now, for most people, after an initial dizziness event, most people, 70% of them is what the literature looks like, go on to recover. They have neuro-otologic recovery, meaning recovering that vestibular system or medical or emotional, because this is really also very scary when it happens. They go on to recovery and maybe just need a little bit of therapy, if that. And there are reasons that occurs, right? So those are what we call, so in that like kind of like bright yellow, it's kind of neon yellow, huh? Positive neuroplasticity factors. So not having a comorbid neurologic disease or autoimmune disease or endocrine disorder, not having some of those other things that also affect the brain and its ability to adapt. Lifestyle factors, so fitness level and brain health and sleep. Sleep is a really big one. Other psychosocial factors. So are you around other people when this happened? Did you feel safe and supported? So that sense of safety can help the brain make the right connections and recovery. So all of those things are really helping the recovery standpoint, which is why they're really a big part of recovering from 3PD as well as other functional neurologic disorders. On the other end, why might people head down this pathway of having 3PD, of having a persistent postural perceptual dizziness after that initial dizziness event? So here's where we can see some other factors come into play. And again, these make sense. So if we are having other things that are affecting our brain health, our nervous system, and how our brain makes connections and wires together. So immune system, genetics can be a piece, other neurologic disorders. This is why concussion is so big, because we've had a metabolic event as well. So dizziness event, metabolic event, it can send us down this pathway of just neuroplasticity gone awry. And so we have those comorbid factors. We have lifestyle factors. Like I mentioned, sleep deprivation is a really big one, but even diets, deconditioning. And there's also psychosocial factors. So what if this occurred during a pandemic? Hello, isolation, a lot of fear of the unknown, fear of getting a virus that is deadly. So it makes sense that those would contribute to the brain staying in this mode of protection. It's not the person. This is our system that is coming together, and it's the brain, it's the body, it's our context, environment, it's many things that come together to make and form and make stronger brain connections. So these things contribute to us then developing things like visual dependence or heavily weighting the visual input. That makes sense. That was part of the acute adaptation, and it stayed there. In fact, it got reinforced to such an extreme that it's hard to break out of it. And that's where therapy comes into play. It's to decrease visual dependence and increase the use of the other systems, like the sensory system. So decrease integration on the cortex level in the brain, cognitive dysfunction. So we can actually see disrupted spatial orientation, for example, and decreased cognitive flexibility. And again, this is because the connection pieces are too strong in some areas. So like the visual, I often think of it as a scale. So the brain is heavily weighting the visual system and underweighting the sensory system, for example. And so you see the scales tip. And these get tipped, particularly in some pieces, and this is part of the 3PD diagnosis, upright posture or motion or visual demands. I often think of this whenever I go to a big store like Bed Bath & Beyond with a lot of visual demand. There we see the symptoms. Now here's the good news, and you can see this at the bottom of the diagram, therapy. Often an interdisciplinary therapy like PT, OT, and psychology. You've heard me talk about a lot of this in functional neurologic disorders, but because this is brain connection between multiple areas gone awry, it often requires brain reconnection from multiple areas, which is multiple disciplines. The good news is that people can have full recovery through therapy for 3PD. So that's really the purpose of this little diagram, is to go through how 3PD might develop and why it's considered a functional neurologic disorder, because it's that functional connectivity really gone awry, and then how we can use those same principles to reconnect and restore. And Brian just left a comment, just left the gym using your resources, still recovering from my flare, but I'm doing stuff I didn't do even before it, which is amazing, like working out. Working out, your fitness level is one of those positive neuroplasticity factors. So what I love is like Brian's taking it on, taking charge, and doing those things that can drive brain connection in the right direction, even after a really rough flare. So thanks for sharing that, that little tidbit, Brian. I think it's really encouraging to know that with some of these things like functional neurologic disorders, 3PD as one of those, that when there's a flare, particularly if some of those negative neuroplasticity factors are there, sleep deprivation, a lot of fear associated with the pandemic, all of those things can come into play into a flare. Heck, if your blood pressure drops low, that in can even flare your dizziness symptoms, right? So knowing that you have the tools to drive recovery in the other direction is so powerful. That control is so powerful. So thank you, Brian. Thanks for sharing that. Thank you all for joining me tonight. I'm gonna work on this diagram so it's a little more readable for everybody and make it bigger. And I will catch you next week. By the way, I almost forgot, on Friday, I'm gonna jump into talking about functional dizziness in the midst of other dizziness disorders. How do you weed through all the different things? And we're gonna connect that to one of my new favorite vestibular topics, which is the otolith function. This is something that Catherine and Jamie, friends, colleagues, neuro nerds like myself, have been talking a lot about with me, and is a big part of their course that we are hosting called A Positive Spin on Dizziness. It's coming up in August, August 28th, and we are doing early bird pricing for it through July 4th. So just through this weekend. So I'm going to be chatting about that on Friday on our Facebook page as well. So you can join me there. And thanks so much for joining me today. I appreciate it. Have a great afternoon, evening, and I will see you on Friday.